Good morning to you all, and a special welcome to all our mothers. We pray that as you are celebrated today, that it'll be a special day for you. So let's pray. Almighty Lord and loving Father, we come today to praise you, to worship you, and to hear from you. And this morning in particular, we want to thank you for our mothers, for all mothers. Thank you for the life that they gave us, the life that they showed us, the love that they showed us, and the nurturing that made us what we are. Please bless them today with a special portion of your love. And for those who long to be mothers, Father, we pray that you would draw them close to you. Surround them with your love and peace, and may they know that you are their everlasting Father. And Father, too, we come to you today and we pray for forgiveness for the sins that we've committed. We are truly sorry. And we ask that you, Jesus, would wash us clean, restore our relationship with God so that again we can call him Father. And Holy Spirit, come and fill us again, that we will be men and women of God who stand in the power of the Almighty, ready to do his will. So Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we sing your praises, worship your name, and listen to your word, we pray that we would remember who you are, the Lord God Almighty, creator of the heavens and the earth, and the lover of our souls. We pray this in and through the name of our Saviour, our brother and our friend, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song.
Sing like never before. deserve for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. They give us strength, help us cope in this world wherever we roam. Ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient
If you have your Bibles, join with me as we read today's reading from 2 Peter chapter 1, from verse 12 through to verse 21.
So I will always remind you of these things, even though you know them and are firmly established in the truth you now have. I think it is right to refresh your memory as long as I live in the tent of this body, because I know that I will soon be put aside, as our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will make every effort to see that after my departure you will always be able to remember these things. For we did not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and you will do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in the dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. For prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit.
An elderly gentleman was telling his friend about a new restaurant that he and his wife had recently visited. And he said the food and the service were great. And his friend asked, well, what's the name of the restaurant? Gee, you know, I can't remember, he said. What do you call that long-stemmed flower that people give on special occasions? Oh, you mean a rose, offered his friend. Yeah, that's it, said the old man, exclaimed, and he turned to his wife across the yard. Rose, what's the name of that restaurant we went to the other day? So let me ask you, how good is your memory? Do you tend to forget things? You know, can you remember your spouse's name? Can you even remember your children's names? Can you remember what day it is today, or has every day just molded into one during this lockdown? What about scripture? Do you remember what the Bible says and where it says it? I must say, we're having a lot of fun learning, and as we do our daily Bible quiz, we're having to scramble around in the Bible to find where the things we remember, where they come from. But what about the Lord and your salvation? Do you remember what the Lord has done for you? Do you remember the commitment that you made to the Lord? See, these are the things that we don't want to forget. And unfortunately, we often forget what we need to remember, and we remember the things that we need to forget, which was often my case at school. I always remembered the useless facts instead of the useful ones. And as we read the Bible, we often see God commanding his people to remember important things. He often gave his people physical, visual aids to help them remember, like the rainbow, to help us remember that he will never again destroy all life by water. And then he gave the sign of circumcision as a reminder to the people of Israel of the covenant of Abraham. What about the Passover? It was a time to remind them of their great deliverance from Egypt. And in a similar fashion, God has given us the Lord's Supper as a reminder of our deliverance from sin through the sacrifice of Christ. You see, God knows how easily we forget and how important it is for us to remember. And as we continue looking at 2 Peter, we see that Peter's doing everything that he can to leave the church some very important reminders. He's basically saying to all of us, don't forget to remember. He knows that false teachers pose a great threat and a danger to the church, both in his time and in ours. So let's see the things that we need to remember. Firstly, we need to remember to be established in the truth. And this first thing that stands out to us is the fact that there is a body of truth that Peter wants to be sure that not only his readers, but us remember. And he compliments his readers by saying, you know them and you are established in the truth that you now have. But he wants to be sure that they remember these things after his departure. And through their preaching and teaching, the apostles and the prophets laid the foundation of the church, which Paul writes about in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20, where he says it was built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Jesus Christ as the cornerstone. And 1 Corinthians 3, verse 11, for where no one can lay any foundation other than which was already laid, which is Jesus Christ. And Peter implies here in verses 12 to 15 that there is a fixed body of truth that must be held to and remembered. Jude describes it like this in Jude 1 verse 3. Dear friends, although I have been eager to write to you about the salvation we share, I felt I had to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to the saints. See, it's a faith conviction of the truth. And when we receive this truth, it establishes us in the truth. And holding on to that truth results in faithfulness and spiritual strength. But why was Peter so urgent and emphatic about reminding them of this truth? Because he knew that his death was near. In 1 John 21, verse 18 and 19, after Jesus' resurrection, Jesus spoke of the end of Peter's life and the fact that it would be a violent death that would bring glory to God. And despite this, his impending death, he's not concerned about himself. He's concerned for those to whom he writes. And he talks of his death. He says, I know that my tent will soon be put aside. You know, it's like taking off an old pair of jeans. But he didn't fear death, and neither should we. Peter saw death not as an end, but as a taking off of the earthly and going out into the eternal glory of God. But before he departs, Peter was committed to do everything possible to establish the church in truth and to help them remember these things after his death. Peter wanted his readers to know the basic truths of Christianity so well that these things defined their lives. And he didn't apologize for repeating these things. In fact, he acknowledged that they already knew these things, but that he was going to go over them again so that they wouldn't forget. Paul wrote something similar in Philippians 3 verse 1. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. There's a human condition termed muscle memory. It's a process whereby you've done something so many times that you do it without even thinking about it anymore. It's like, you know, driving a car with a manual gearbox. No longer do you really listen to the engine noise to know when to press in the clutch and to release the accelerator, to shift the gear lever into the next gear, and then release the clutch and depress the accelerator to the correct position. Oh, is that what I've been doing all these years? And that's what Peter is saying here. So I will always remind you of these things, even though you know them. They must become muscle memory thoughts and actions. But let's mention one final thing about Peter's efforts to help us to remember. He says in verse 15, and I will make every effort to see that after my departure, you will always be able to remember these things. And I believe Peter is talking here about his writings. This very letter that is read screams out, read me again and again as a constant reminder. And I also think about, without realizing it, he was talking about the whole of the New Testament and not just his first and second letters that are part of it. His letters and all the other letters and accounts have been ministering to us for centuries. It's a constant reminder to us of what they wrote concerning the gospel, our hope, Jesus Christ, God, and the Holy Spirit. And secondly, we need to remember that many of the biblical writers were actual eyewitnesses. But why is it important that Peter points out that they did not follow cleverly invented stories or concocted fables, as some translations puts it, but that they were eyewitnesses themselves? As we will see in the rest of Peter's second letter, Peter was combating false teachers and their false teaching. These false teachers were not eyewitnesses, but they had some cleverly concocted fables that they'd come along with. And these false teachers were trying to cause people to depend on their spiritual experiences rather than to depend on the Word of God. Does it sound familiar? And it's these teachings that Peter calls destructive heresies in chapter 2, verse 1 of his second letter. He wants to show the contrast between the apostles, who were eyewitnesses to the truth, and the false teachers who came thinking about the cleverly concocted fables and speculative theories and experiences. He wanted his readers to understand that the Christian faith is based on historical facts, and that he wasn't speculating, nor was he stretching the truth. Rather, he was simply giving his eyewitness account of being with Jesus. And the incident that Peter is pointing out to in these verses is the transfiguration of Jesus that is recorded in Matthew 17 and Mark 9. Of all the things that Peter was eyewitnesses of, why bring up this incident? Why not bring up the feeding of the 5,000 or the raising of Lazarus from the dead or even the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus himself? Why the transfiguration? Because the transfiguration affirms an important doctrine of the Christian faith. You know, like with Jesus' baptism, the transfiguration affirms that Jesus is indeed the Son of God. Peter, James, and John heard the voice of God from the cloud declare, as we read in Matthew 17, verse 5, "This is my dear Son, in whom I delight." So the transfiguration affirms the truth of the scriptures. So Peter declares that he was present for the transfiguration. You know, he says, we ourselves heard it. For it wasn't a second or third hand information or stories that we were told. We ourselves heard it. And he was not only an eyewitness of that, but of so much more. What he knows about Jesus and what Jesus taught came to him firsthand, his own ears and his own eyes. No second or third hand stories passed down. No speculation or clever invention was necessary. And when you think about it, so much of the whole Bible was written by those who were eyewitnesses. As John, a first-hand witness, wrote near the end of his account of the gospel in chapter 20, verse 31, "But these things, what I have seen and I've heard myself, are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that in believing you may have life in his name." And then in chapter 21, verse 24, he continues, it says, "This is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true." Paul wrote much of the New Testament, and though he wasn't a believer during Jesus' ministry, Jesus appeared to him personally after his resurrection, and Paul became an eyewitness then. And James and Jude, both were most likely Jesus' brothers. And if so, then they're definitely eyewitnesses. And many of the writers of the Old Testament were eyewitnesses of the things they wrote about, like Moses and David, Solomon, Ezra, Nehemiah, Daniel, and all the prophets. False teachers were coming along in Peter's day, just as they are today. And they weren't eyewitnesses, yet they were teaching something very different about Jesus than those that had been eyewitnesses. They were coming with new doctrines and revelations that were out of line with the first-hand experiences. And this is an important thing for us to remember. We must trust the eyewitness accounts and not those of others who claim to have new teachings and extra-biblical revelations, dreams and visions and prophecies outside of the Word of God. Personal visions of Jesus instead of the Jesus revealed in Scripture, as John writes in his first letter, chapter 1. "The life appeared, and we have seen it and testified to it." But there is even a more important thing for us to remember. We need to remember that the Bible is inspired by God. When Peter says, "And we have the word of the prophets made more certain," he was saying that the Old Testament prophets spoke of the same things that he did, and that their words are more certain because of the transfiguration being a preview of their fulfillment. In other words, the glory of Jesus on the mountaintop and the visions of the prophets combine to make it certain that the second coming of Jesus is a living reality which all people must expect and for which we should prepare. And Peter says that we should pay attention to it like a light shining in a dark place. And if you've ever walked around with only a torch on a moonless night, you'll know the importance of paying attention to that small area that the torch lights up. The world is a dark place, and therefore we need the light of the lamp of God's word. As the psalmist says in Psalm 119, verse 105, that we should be focusing on the promises of the scripture until the day dawns and the morning star rises in our hearts. All of this is an obvious allusion to the day of Christ's coming. And Jesus himself calls himself the bright morning star in Revelation 22, verse 16, where he says, "I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright morning star." So certainly Peter is pointing us towards the second coming of Jesus. Peter then ends this section with two of the best verses in the Bible that explain how Scripture is inspired by God. Peter wants us to know and to remember that the Scriptures are not merely the words of men, but are the very words of God. And first he declares, "For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, or by the prophet's own imagination." And secondly, he declares, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. And that's Peter's point. The origin of Scripture is God, not man. Scripture did not come through human invention, imagination, or will. Rather, it comes from God. And all of this is an amazing mystery. Men spoke and wrote, but God so worked in them so that what they said and what they wrote was His word. It was not through a process of dictation or through a state of ecstasy that the writers of the Scripture spoke, but through the control of the Spirit of God. These men were inspired not in the same way that we think of people like Shakespeare and Mozart or Rembrandt were inspired. Theirs was a work of genius. The writing of the Scripture, on the other hand, was the work of the Holy Spirit. And keep in mind that the Word of God was written to common people, not to theological professors. The writers assumed that common people would read it and understand it and apply it, being led by the Holy Spirit who had inspired it. The humble individual believer can learn about God as they read and meditate on the Word of God. No one needs the experts to do any interpreting, although this doesn't deny the ministry of teachers who have been given their special gifts of explaining and applying the Scriptures. Nor does this deny the place of the collective wisdom of the church over the ages, as the word has been studied and the doctrine has been clarified. But we should be very cautious of the new interpretations and teaching. It doesn't seem reasonable that billions of people over thousands of years would be completely wrong and in the dark about the meaning of Scripture when suddenly there are new interpretations and teachings. God has given us a powerful scripture about Scripture. In 2 Timothy 3 verse 16, where he says that all Scripture is God-breathed and it is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Bible is God's word, and it is powerful and useful. We should love it, strive to learn it, and to live it. When Jack Nicklaus was the undisputed number one golfer in the world, he was asked how he kept on the top of his game. His answer was interesting and very applicable for us. He said at the end of every golf season, he went back to his first coach who taught him the basics of golf and had him reteach him the basics all over again. Every year he went back and he learned the basic building blocks of a good golf swing. There wasn't anything new to learn. There was just the need to be reminded again of the basics. And it worked for Jack Nicklaus, and he's widely regarded as one of the greatest professional golfers of all time because he won 18 major championships over a span of 25 years. And spiritually speaking, the same approach can work for us. We must not forget to remember. We must remember to be established in the truth and review it regularly. We must remember that many of the biblical writers were actual eyewitnesses, that they truthfully passed on what they saw and heard and experienced. And we must remember that the Bible is inspired by God. Where are you this morning? Are you established in the truth of Jesus Christ? Maybe it's not that you don't know the truth, but maybe you've forgotten the value of it. Maybe you need to be reminded that the Bible is different and unique, and above all, that it is God's Word. Maybe you needed to be reminded of the need to establish yourself and your family in the truth. Or maybe you needed the encouragement of the second coming to keep you walking faithfully. But whatever you do, don't forget to remember. Let's pray. Gracious and loving Father, thank you that no matter what happens, you want us to remember that our salvation is established in truth, that what we know and believe is not mere hearsay or thoughts or ideas of men, but that it comes from those who knew your Son, walked with him and talked with him, ate with him. And thank you that your word, the book that we call our Bible, despite being written by fallible men, was inspired by your infallible Holy Spirit, that it has survived time and is alive and is your word to us. Help us to not only love your word, but to hold it within our hearts as your sacred word for us and to us. Give us a fresh love and an understanding for your word as we seek to live as your children, loved by you, saved by your Son, and empowered by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's join in singing, "In Christ Alone My Hope Is Found."
In Christ alone, who took
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with each and every one, and help you to remember that we are all established as his children in the truth. Amen.
Now unto him who is able to keep, able to keep us from falling, and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
God bless you all, and may you have a wonderful Mother's Day.
Or think, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.